Cats and watermills go together as closely as anything you can think of. If you have cats around, you're far less likely to have the mice and the rats, which of course the flower would have attracted. But watermills are an inherent part of the English countryside. They've been around here for well over 1,000 years, far longer than there have been windmills in the country. And this particular mill itself dates back before Doomsday. How you can tell whether it's a watermill? Well, look right up to the top. The lucum is the giveaway sign that it is a mill, because the grain as it comes along, it goes onto the hoist and straight up inside. The grain as it gradually gets turned into flour comes down through the building and comes out in sacks from this store. It was loaded onto wagons which would come up against this white board here and then they'd set off. The building as you can see it today is really from about 1780 overall, although various parts date from much earlier. It's rather like old churches, they're added to and changed over the years. But the key working part that enables all of this to happen is of course the water. This water is the mill head, and what that means is there's a high enough amount of water to tip into the mill to make the machinery work inside. And that height is achieved by the sluice lifting the water. And yet, with a historic building like this one, the landscape itself is equally historic. And in reality, just as much part of the machinery of the workings of the mill. Just upstream from here is the mill marsh, and that is really an integral part in the protection of the landscape and control of the water levels.
I'm taking a voyage, not just today to the marsh, but throughout the series in different programmes. I'll be exploring the river and going into the mill itself to find out about its working life and pastimes, and to see now how its retirement from work is bringing changes to the mill and its surroundings. In many ways, the story of the mill and its valuable role in the landscape typifies the story of watermilling in lowland Britain. The wildlife and rich riverside plants upstream of the mill owe their very existence to the high water levels maintained by the mill's sluice. On the land, the lush growth of the mill's marsh is a welcome wet oasis in the midst of the arable, dry areas of the east of England.
One of the great joys of the marsh is that it's an aromatic delight, and you can use your nose to help you identify the plants as you go around. And for this plant, it's particularly important because this is hemlock, and it's so poisonous that the ancient Greeks used it to put Socrates to death. But if you go around and smell, there's a very characteristic odour there, which I quite like, and I appreciate not everybody would, because it's the smell of mice, and there's a real mousy smell hanging over the whole marsh today. But if you've got no sense of smell at all, there are other things to look for. It's a very tall plant. It's a member of the umbellifer or umbrella-shaped flower family, and you can see them dotted all over it. But as well as its height, on its stems, to give you some indication of how dangerous it is, there are blood-red blotches, so if you see those, beware. But here's another member of that same family, this umbrella-shaped family, and when you smell this, ooh, it smells of pigs. There's no way you'd mistake the two. And the smell of pigs is quite right, because this is hogweed.
Its smell and use went together, for the coarse leaves of hogweed used to be gathered from the marsh to supplement the diet of the mill's pigs. And it was vital for those gathering them to be able to tell them apart from the feathery ones of poisonous hemlock. The marsh provided an invaluable source of plant products for those living beside the mill across the centuries, whilst at the same time sustained a superb habitat for wildlife. The marsh has been managed to be usefully productive whilst appearing wild for as long as the mill has existed. Straddling the old river and the millhead channel, it continues to reduce the risk of flooding at the mill by acting as an overflow and sponge.
One plant you get all over the marsh is purely as a result of the river to have it in this abundance, and that's the nettle. It's absolutely everywhere and puts some people off going into English marshes. But the reason it's in such abundance is because every winter, when the force of water that brings down the silt throws it out onto the land, then that silt provides food for these hungry feeders, and they make the most of it and really try and dominate the marsh at the expense of all other plants. But they are quite an aggressive plant, as we know, because if you walk through, people will very easily get stung. There's a trick, you can avoid getting stung. If you just run your arm gently through a nettle bed, you won't get stung. Now, the reason for that is because all over the leaves there are minute hairs which do the stinging, but they're really like little glass vials. And if you snap that neck off of the glass vial, then you'll inject yourself with the formic acid and the other toxins, and that will bring on the rash. But if you don't quite break it, but just distort that neck, then all is well. But that protection that the plant has is very useful, and it's not just useful to the plant. Because not only does it tend to keep us out from walking through nettle beds, but it keeps cattle and other animals out, so the nettle bed stays there, and that's a great advantage to insects. And there's over 40 species of insects that use the nettle bed as somewhere to bring up their offspring. And caterpillars, from butterflies in particular, are able to thrive very well.
In the bed of nettles, some caterpillars walk about on the leaves, while others make protective webs. And still others pull leaves into sheltering tents. A few species take the extreme safeguard of wrapping a leaf around themselves, like rolled up cigars. Careful opening of one of these reveals a lone moth caterpillar and its mound of droppings. The small tortoiseshell is so common, it's often assumed it will lay on any patch of nettles. However, its fussiness means that large areas like the marsh are essential for its choice. The peacock butterfly, like the small tortoiseshell, belongs to an exclusive group of large, showy, colourful butterflies, often referred to as the aristocrats, that rear their young on the Mills Marsh nettles. At the end of each wing, they have large eye spots to scare off predatory birds. The butterflies actively feed on a range of nectar-bearing flowers around the marsh, including forget-me-not, drinking through their proboscis. Many will overwinter by hibernating in the cool roof space of the tall mill. This pale, green-veined white's preferred habitat is the wet, grassy woodland of the marsh, unlike its cultivated cabbage-eating relatives. Another aristocratic dweller in the Mills Marsh is the comma, with its irregular-shaped wings. Hop leaves are the main food of its young, and this native plant grows wild in the marsh, its tendrils clambering among the nettles. When cultivated hops became grown less in the last century, the butterfly's numbers crashed. Fortunately, this century, it's taken more advantage of nettles. In the Mills Marsh, it's spoilt for choice with both. For the adult commas, thistles are a favourite source of nectar. A good range of grasses grow in the Mills Marsh, and these provide food for the young of a distinctive group of butterflies, the skippers. This is a small skipper. In the marsh are small, large and Essex skippers. All three of these beautiful orange-gold butterflies hold their forewings raised when resting, unlike other British butterflies. All three skip restlessly from flower to flower, which gave them the name Skipper. A nectar-rich flower favoured by the skippers and bees is the scrambling yellow vetchling. The ghost of the Mills Marsh is the white plume moth, with cruciform feather-like wings. It anxiously skitters about, like a long-lost soul of a long-dead miller. Everywhere you look, the marsh is alive with activity, with a richness that arises from the life-sustaining habitat that has existed for centuries due to the mill.
Ah. If you're a gardener, this is a plant you love to hate. It's goosegrass or cleavers. It seems to be tangled over everything. But of course, that's not what's involved. It's not tangled. It's employing an extremely clever strategy. And it's a strategy which may seem out of place in your garden, but here in the marsh, it's a superb advantage. And strangely, it's not just an advantage to this plant, it's also an advantage to other plants as well. Because what it has all over it are a series of little Velcro-like hooks that can hang on to things, and extremely weak stems as well. Now, those Velcro hooks enable the seeds, in fact, I'm covered in them myself, so you can see how extremely well they work. You only have to walk through anywhere like this. You get covered with these, what seem like sticky seeds, and of course you spread them around. But the rest of the plant is as well. And those weak stems enable when other stronger plants like these nettles grow up. This plant is just held on them. So as it gets higher and higher, this is always on top. But as it's on top, it gets all of the light. And so it can grow and develop. And then the huge weight of this larger and larger plant gradually crushes everything down. And so you end up with a situation where light gets in back into areas of the marsh. It's been all one table and suddenly it opens up again. In high summer, this is now what you see.
Either side of the path, areas of nettles have collapsed like packs of cards, which allows new growth to come up from their base alongside other plants. That new succulent growth is appreciated by a wide range of insects, including this green bush cricket. But below the nettles, where the streams and rivers run, the marsh is a haven for frogs. Sadly, frogs have become almost a rarity in the dry east of England, where drainage means they're hardly ever seen in the proper countryside away from garden ponds. But here, in the Mills Marsh, they thrive in their thousands. The reason is not hard to find. The mill sluice has kept water levels as they used to be in river valleys, so that even in high summer, conditions are ideal for frogs. The burrs of burdock, like the stings of nettles, may not be appreciated by us, but their flowers provide rich food for bumblebees. Not everything in the marsh looks approachable, and even this devil's coach horse beetle beats a hasty retreat. Bright uniformed soldier beetles may look more attractive, but their colour is a warning to the birds of the marsh to avoid their nasty taste. But with so much rich, moist soil about, the blackbirds have no shortage of worms for their chicks. Growing as tall as a man is the stately great willow herb, and apart from the nettle, this is the most characteristic plant of the Watermill's marsh. Its delicious-looking flowers, rosy with white centres, have given it the country name of codlins and cream. To some noses, the flowers and leaves, when crushed, smell of cooked codlin apples. It's a plant that thrives beside rivers and in marshes, and the mill's ancient waterways provide perfect conditions. And in turn, bees prosper on its abundant flowers. Everywhere you look, the codlins and cream bring a profusion of colour to the marsh. The willow part of their name is due to the similar appearance of their narrow leaves to those of willows that surround them. A harmony of marshland shape that allows them to bend and not break in a breeze. The Watermill's marsh, with its waving willows, is thought to have been in continuous management for marsh hay and wood, possibly from Saxon times, when the land was owned by Harold before he became king. It owes its continued existence to the bank that was constructed when the mill was first made, which runs from the mill to the end of the marsh and forms an artificial channel, not only taking water to the mill, but keeping it at the same height at the mill as at the other end of the marsh, despite the fall of the land. At the mill, this gives a 15-foot head of water above the natural fall, and that power has worked the mill for centuries. Upstream of the sluice and mill, the ancient bank containing the mill head stands proud above the water. As the surrounding farmland has become drained to intensive arable, the distinction between it and the Watermill's marsh beyond the river and its bank has become dramatic. Rising out of the marsh are many fine, straight willows. These are cricket bat willows, a straight variety of the native white willow. This new form was first found not far from here in the early days of cricket, when the need for light but straight bats arose. A male tree has never been found, so they're all struck by pushing a cut branch into the ground.
This is a cricket bat willow tree, and one of the great things about a marsh in this part of England is that the cricket bat is grown as a crop. Now, that enables somebody who owns the land to get some return, some economic justification for keeping part of the countryside still fully advantaged to wildlife. With the small amount of return they get from this, it really helps to pay for the countryside just looking good. But that doesn't mean it's without any attention, because out of this trunk are going to come real cricket bats. What happens is that when it's felled, you'll get a series of sections from which cricket bats can be split. But the trunk itself needs some management, some maintenance. It's not just a recipe for cash. All of these side shoots need to be trimmed off, because if you don't take these pieces off of here, what is eventually going to happen is that instead of having a trunk out of which you can get a number of cricket bats, you're just going to get a whole series of knots occurring, and that, for somebody who enjoys cricket, is just not cricket.
On one cricket bat tree, some of the branches have died due to the infectious bacterial watermark disease. Because of the risk to the cricket bat industry, this is a notifiable disease. But unfortunately, the disease is widespread in cricket bat willow growing areas.
When the tree's down, you can see why those branches were dying off at the top. The infection that's got in has been spreading around. And not only is that going to stain a cricket bat and therefore make it not very popular with cricketers, but it itself can cause the death of the tree. So sadly, this 10-year-old one had to be felled.
Fortunately, the rest of the cricket bat willows beside the mill and in the marsh seem fine. The University of East Anglia has developed disease-free trees, and some are being tried out in the marsh. Healthy trees are felled at 15 years of age. Although planting the trees allows marsh to be kept, unfortunately today, most manufacturers insist on clear felling. The company that takes willows from this marsh are conservation-minded and take just a few trees a year, so there's always a range of ages and the habitat survives. A healthy tree has been felled and taken to the conservation-minded cricket bat makers Gray-Nicolls, and the willow manager, Derek Boone, has promised to show me it being turned into bats.
When you're ready.
First, the log is split into clefts, like a cake being cut, and then sawn to shape.
This is the cleft being turned into a what we call a blade. The blade's been dried down to a moisture content of 16 to 18% and at this stage comes into the factory to be processed. This is a pressing process which presses the face of the bat to save a lot of knocking in. It compresses the face of the bat roughly about 1/8 of an inch. The handle's made of Malaysian pine or Indonesian cane, and this is what we call a 9-piece handle, which is the best handle we make. They're put through a machine here which takes the cane off of each side. 3 pieces are glued together like that and then put back through the machine with this process. We then put 3 pieces together to make the handle. The centre one, which is cut down the middle to make room for 3 springs. So what we've actually got, we've got 3 pieces there, then a spring, then the cut down piece, spring, the other cut down piece, spring and the outside piece. In amongst this, we put a wedge in, a willow wedge in the end, and that takes up the shape of the bat. The fitting of a cricket bat handle is one of the most highly skilled parts of making a cricket bat and also one of the most critical. It's fitted in with a croid glue, which is an animal glue, which doesn't set hard. It never really sets solid and has a certain amount of give in it. And allied to the springs in the handle gives the cricket bat its flexibility.
the finished bat, which grew in a marsh that has been kept for centuries due to a watermill.
One of the advantages of working around in a marsh all day and looking at its wildlife in a historic landscape is that you can feel at the end of it you deserve a decent historic break. So I'm making my way upstream to the local village pub, where over a pint I'm going to watch a game of cricket beside the river. And with any luck, one of the bats will have been made from one of the trees here. And there'll be a certain feeling of satisfaction of a job well done.
In the next programme, I'll be looking at the Mills River.